Okay, so we're going to get going here. Thanks for coming out tonight. All of you people have your priorities straight. You're not going to let that debate get in the way. So how many of you, it's your first mobile portal meeting? Cool. So we'll go through this pretty quickly. Most of you are repeats again this month. So we're out mobile. You the fourth one day of the month. We're modeled after international organization called Mobile Mondays, but we're not actually affiliated with them. So we have a few websites, mobileportal.com. We have a Google group, which is for everybody to kind of talk about projects, or if they're hiring, or, you know, we know all of it. We also have a mailing list you can get to on the website, and all that really is we email you a couple times a month just to tell you what the meeting is going to be, and what it's about. We also have a Twitter account at Mobile Portland, and that sort of is announcements, and sometimes we tweet some other interesting things. And I'm going to keep beating this. We have an IRC channel. There's like four of us. Ask Mobile Portland on Freenode if you're a nerd. Please come up. So we don't really have any events right now. This is not the event season anyway. So we've got tonight. Next one, remember, it's going to be on the 12th, and it's not going to be here. I don't know if they're saying where it is yet.
Yeah,
it's okay. Yeah, it's going to be over Ziva, actually. We're moving next month. So we'll send an announcement about that. It should be a really good talk. Just remember that we're changing. So now come around if you have any announcements about job openings, need help with a project, have an event going on. Other people might be interested in, I'll come around.
Thank you. Hi, Laura Wallace from Upfront Software. Actually, I want to talk about Angel Oregon a little bit. It's a great investment and entrepreneurship conference that's coming up in the first quarter of next year. But we're going to be recruiting entrepreneurs for both launch stage companies and concept stage companies starting next month. So if you're interested in learning more about it, please come see me, and I'll be here next month with a little bit more detail on the events.
Hey everyone, I'm Clinton. This is really awkward for me because I'm usually the one saying, I really need a job. But I actually am hiring an animator for a mobile game that I'm working on called Clobber, and it's super cute. So I'm looking for anyone who's got a 2D cartoon animation experience. Probably nobody in the room, but I thought I'd try. And probably somebody you might know. And I have money to pay somebody, which is crazy. It's almost broke.
Just so everyone knows, tomorrow night, an organization called New Tech Society, maybe someone who's visited their happy hours downtown, we're going to do the happy hour on the west side. Also at the Thursday night, just like the museum town. From 5-ish till about 7 o'clock. If you haven't been to the West Side Thirsty Line, it's over by Washington Square for the Kachina Kachinis. You can look up more on LinkedIn, too, under New Tech Society.
Well, my name is Tim Albrecht. I did this announcement for a couple months, but I work with a soft source consultant we have. On an ongoing basis, including .NET developers who are looking for 5 years plus experience in C#, and as mentioned last time, we still have a referral bonus in my iPad if you recruit yourself or a friend in your community.
Alright. I really need a microphone. Anyway,
just so everyone knows, also, we're doing this Windows 8 thing here tonight. Now, I'll mention that there also is a Windows 8 Code with Experts this weekend in Redmond. But for those of you who don't want to go to Redmond on Saturday, we are doing the same thing on November 10th. From about 8:30 a.m. is registration, 9 o'clock, we begin the presentations, and goes all day. Morning's going to be the panel. available for questions and answers. We'll have a lunch, and then the afternoon will be actual coding time. If you have an idea of something you want to develop for Windows 8, or if you just want to participate with someone who already has an idea, come on out. The event's going to be over at the Enbridge Center over off of MLK, right? Someone who goes?
Yes,
you've been to Enbridge?
I've not.
Is MLK, or you can be the other one?
I've never been.
Okay. So over by the Convention Center. And with that, I'll pass it on.
Okay, that's it. So thank you to our sponsors, Urban Airship. They give us this space every month, which is really great. I can be here. And I don't think there's anybody here to talk. I assume, are still hiring for lots of wealth positions. If you need a job, you can come check them out. And also to Cloud 4. They buy food, and I think Jason might have something to talk about.
Hey, thanks everybody. With Cloud 4, so is Matt. We've been organizing this for a while. So if you guys are interested in anything sort of mobile web or related, we'd be interested in talking to you. But actually, what I want to talk about is the fact that we're continuing to work on the device lab. On mobileplugin.com now, there's a list of devices that people can come and test with. Out. I'm sure that it's fine. Nobody panic. just kidding. So there's a list of devices that we've got access to. So if you're interested in testing, take a look. See if there's a device that you need on that list. And on November 12th, we'd love if you have extra devices that you would like to donate to Mobile Portland to bring those devices to the meeting at Ziva. Let's see, what else? You can schedule time to go look at the test lab. We're still planning for the summer of 2013 to be when we have a physical location for the device lab. Other things, the Amazon's director of their app store will be our speaker in November on the 12th, so I highly recommend people come join. And if you've never been to the Ziva Design Space, their auditorium, really, really cool. They like design their own chairs because they're that way. So you should come at minimum to check out the seating. And finally, I have a Windows 8 tablet, which will be in the device lab as well now that Jeremy has confirmed that it's actually something that we can talk about. I wasn't sure whether that was the case or not. So I've got one if people want to play around with it after.
Okay, so that's it for announcements. And so tonight we've got Jeremy Foster, he's a developer evangelist from Microsoft. He's here to talk about Windows 8 and more specifically developing for Windows 8. Here he is.
Hey, thank you. Hey, everybody. As he said, Jeremy Foster, I'm a developer evangelist at Microsoft. I've been so for about 8 months, so it's not been long. Before then, I was heads down in development, doing web development for the last many years. Worked at an insurance company, and I worked in the aerospace industry. In the aerospace industry, I was working on a number of different big projects, like the Boeing 787 for quite a while, which was exciting. And then I worked on an Airbus project in Spain, which was exciting, and then I switched to insurance. Took a dramatic drop in drama and prestige and all that, but it was actually some pretty exciting code, and that's what I geek out on, so it was kind of fun, so I've gathered some experience like that. But now I'm working at Microsoft. This is kind of the role that I've been looking to fill for the last 10 years or so, because I not only get to code, but I get to talk to people. So that's a blast. And what I'm going to talk with you guys tonight about is Windows 8, and specifically the HTML and JavaScript side of the house. This is the first time that Microsoft has released a platform that was kind of multifaceted, and that you can attack it from a few different, entirely disparate coding verticals. You can come in with just web platform experience, and you can write a Windows 8 app. Or you can come in with some Microsoft experience, some XAML and C Sharp, and you can write the same Windows app. Or you can use your native experience and use things like C++ and DirectX and XAML and write a Windows 8 app. So it's just different ways to skin the exact same cat. So, but I'm kind of an HTML JavaScript person. I've been on the web for a long time. Like you, I've pulled out plenty of hair writing div alignment. And so I'm thrilled in this space because I think that Microsoft did an incredible job at implementing a native platform on the web platform. All of the standards are completely enforced. All of the standards are completely followed. Where there is no support for something in the web platform, Microsoft made a standards compliant, vendor specific tag and implemented it. And as soon as that element is available, in the standards, then it'll switch from the vendor-specific tag to the standard tag. So it's really exciting stuff. But I want to talk not just about development, but I'm also going to talk to you about the design, because not only is this the first time we've developed or we've delivered a platform with these disparate verticals, but we also are delivering not just a development platform, but also a design platform. It's very comprehensive. If you haven't seen it already, it's very impressive. If you go to dev.windows.com, you get the hub for developers for developing Windows 8 apps. And if you go to design.windows.com, you get like the design hub. You get the starting point for anybody designers. So if you're kind of the design type, go there. Or if you know somebody who is, tell them that's where they should go if they want to learn about Windows 8 design. Okay? Now I've got basically three different presentations. Give that a try. I've got three different presentations. The first one is a consumer's introduction to Windows 8, and then the second one is a designer's introduction, and then the third is a developer's introduction. I'm going to skip over the consumers because we've only got like now about 40 minutes. I'm going to assume that you guys have had the consumer's introduction. If you haven't, the rest of it's going to make sense, but you might want to go watch the consumer, the Welcome to Windows 8 RP on YouTube or something like that. It'll make total sense. I think most of you are developers, so you know this stuff anyway. But the design stuff, we absolutely can't skip. The development stuff, we have to have at least a basic introduction. And then we have to have time to kind of distill all this. I know you guys are going to have good questions. I always get really good questions in these crowds because a lot of people are wondering a lot of different things. So I'm going to kind of try to split my time between design and development, and then I'll just be standing here letting you guys fire questions at me. Cool? So let's start with design. We're talking about designing Windows 8, but we're really talking, when we implement our design, it's with the web platform, okay? So think HTML, CSS here. But when I talk about Windows 8 design, I'm not just talking about the implementation of graphical design. I'm not talking about just, you know, the graphical design itself. I'm talking about user experience design, the whole thing. The architecture of the app, the architecture of the views to support your application so that even if you've got great code, you know that if the user can't use it, it's worth nothing. Even if you've got great code and the user can use it, he doesn't love it, it's not worth hardly anything. Because the user has to absolutely love your app, and that's what we're after. This looks like a lot of, this is my overview for this section, it looks like a lot of content. This is actually about an hour and a half presentation that I'm distilling down to about 20 minutes. So we're going to go really fast, and actually most of our time is going to be spent in the first point, our content before Chrome, because it is by far the most important design principle in Windows 8. And then the rest we're going to kind of speed through so that you get at least an introduction to it. But content before Chrome is critical, and defining these terms is critical. What is content? What is Chrome? Well, content is everything your user came to see. You made an app. The user wants to open it. Why? Because it's a social app and he wants to see his friends. The friends are the content. Because it's a newsreader app and he wants to read the news. The articles and the supporting media are key. That's the content, okay? The Chrome is defined as everything that's going to distract your user from that content. And there's usually a lot of Chrome in apps. And we've been going this way for a long time. And we see it all over the place, and we need to get rid of Chrome. And I'm not talking about Google Chrome, I'm just talking about Chrome. But you would expect expect me to say that, right?
So the reason for this is because of this design philosophy of immersing the user in something they love. Absolutely immersing them, okay? And then the reason why we get rid of the Chrome is because we want to minimize the things that are distracting the user from that immersion. Now this is a drawing that we actually did in a test lab asking users, what is your, sketch out your experience with classic legacy Windows applications. This is what they drew. Not surprising at all, we all recognize it. We've got closed buttons in Windows and all kinds of things. The thing to note here is that there is no content on the screen. All we see right now is Chrome. We've essentially got information about information, but we have no information. Okay? We've got ways to launch our content, ways to close our content, things to contain our content, but that's all we have. Now, when we ask the same users to sketch their experience with a early release of Windows 8, this is what they drew. It looks like, if you guys have seen some Windows 8 apps, it looks a lot like it. And the thing I want to point out is that this is entirely content. There's nothing on the screen except for content. Okay? We've got tiles, and they represent the friends, the stock prices, the pictures. Whatever it is that your app is all about, that's what's there. And this is an absolutely massive paradigm shift in the computing world. From a user experience standpoint, this is an absolutely massive paradigm shift, because now, when the user closes your application, they're not remembering how they use it. They're remembering the content. They're remembering the pictures of the friends and the price of the stock and things like that. So this is really, really critical. Now there's this Chrome that I'm proposing we just throw out the window. Is important. This Chrome is really important for a few reasons. We tend to find that the Chrome represents three different things: layout, interactions, and navigation. Now the layout is the Chrome, the actual pixels that appear on the screen for the sole purpose of dividing up pieces of content from other pieces of content. And we need to make sure that people understand what goes where, so that's important. There's interactions. Interactions are buttons and select boxes and things like that, ways that your user is interacting with your application. And those are important. The user needs to be able to interact with your application. And finally, there's navigation. Your user needs to be able to get around in the application. That's really important. But we're going to replace these three things with different methods for them that don't distract the user from their content. For layout, what we're going to do is we're going to not be afraid to use space and to use it liberally. We now have, from edge to edge on our screen, from pixel to pixel, actually, I take that back. There's one pixel at the edge of the screen that captures the swipe from off the screen so that you can reveal your charms bar, reveal your app bar, and reveal your navigation bar and things like that. So there's one pixel dedicated to that, but you can't see it. So we have from edge to edge for our app, and so we're not afraid to use 120 pixels or so for a nice margin that separates content. That's one way in which we handle the layout. Another way is with typography. So the typography in the Windows 8 app is extremely intentional, extremely purposeful. We have a standard type ramp and a standard type, font face. So the font face is SIGO UI. And the type ramp is 42 point, 20 point, 11 point, 9 point. And each of those means something deliberately. So the title you're going to see is 42 point. The next header is going to be 20 point and on down. Okay? And the user grows accustomed to this type ramp, and it indicates a hierarchy of the elements on the screen. Now, does everybody know this app? RSS Reader? Even if you don't, you do, because it looks like every other app in the whole world, right? Every other classic Windows app. You instantly know what's going on here. You've got some feeds on the left, some headlines on the top right, and then an individual article on the bottom. Now, there's layout Chrome, there's interaction Chrome, and there's navigation Chrome all going on here. So it's a good example of all three of those things that we're trying to get rid of. I have a question for you. Where in this view is the content? Yeah, right there. Exactly. It's maybe 20 or 25% of the app is dedicated to the content that the user is actually reading right now. The rest of it is, as we like to say, it's information about where the user might go but isn't currently. And in Windows 8, we want to tell users about where they are currently. Okay? So we're going to use this as an example. We're going to talk about how to turn this into a Windows 8 app. There we go. So we've got some layout. You can see the type ramp here. You can see the 42-point headlines, the 20-point design milk, which is a category. It's a section title. You can see the liberal use of space that kind of forms a C, or the letter C around the content, inviting us to pan to the right and view more off-screen content. And what we're looking at here is entirely content. And I'm going to show you how the three types of Chrome are replaced with this. And if I turn on this overlay, you can see that it's really forming what we call the design silhouette, so that this app conforms to the design silhouette and instantly looks like a Windows 8 app. It instantly looks familiar to the user. Now, the interactions that we need to replace are done in three different ways. First of all, we let the content command for itself. I'll show you more about that in a second. We also make sure we leverage the edge of the screen, which is a really new and innovative way to handle user interactions. And we also provide some context, some contextual commands, so that they don't appear until the user invites them. So this is a whatever app knows, but my point here is that if I want to know more information about the scarf or the football or something like that, I know intuitively that all I have to do is touch that. So I don't have to draw Chrome on the screen to invite the user to touch to get more information about something. That kind of navigation is going to happen intuitively. So that's just going to take care of itself. Likewise, and this is just kind of an exaggeration of the same principle, we've got a list of products here. Imagine there are pictures in there. That's not part of the content. But we've got these little buttons that are rendered on all of those. Now, those buttons, they make this app very discoverable, right? Because I can see instantly that for any of those products, I could just touch the heart and like it, or I could touch the mail and send it, or whatever. So I'm not arguing that we are increasing or even maintaining the same level of discoverability. But when we Windows 8ify this app, we get rid of that distraction. We get rid of that Chrome. And we focus on the content. We now purely have a list of products. Okay? We're looking just at the list of products, and the interactions have gone away. Now, where do the interactions go? Here we're leveraging the edge. We get an app bar that's revealed when the user selects any item or multiple items. Automatically, the app bar comes up. You have that power as a developer to bring that app bar up and make it stay. And now you get to do the same three things to any items that you select, but you don't do so until the user invites it. Okay? Now, this takes a little bit of learning from the user. I'm thinking 3 minutes or something, where a user, when he gets a Windows 8 device, it takes a little bit of time for him to realize this is how it works. You select things by swiping on them, and when I select things, normally I get that part here. But as soon as he knows that, then he knows how to do that. And as soon as you know how to turn a doorknob, you know how to open every door in the world, right? So the user's going to learn that, and he's going to know. Now, if we look at replacing these interactions by leveraging the edge, the user, again, within a few minutes of using the platform, realizes that he can always invite that application bar up from the bottom of the screen, and he can always invite the charms bar over from the right. So if, for instance, I'm using this RSS reader, and all of a sudden I want to refresh and bring in new content, before I would have had a refresh button somewhere on the screen taking up pixels, right? Now I don't. But as even a pretty new Windows 8 user, I know I can just swipe up from the bottom and I'm going to get a number of commands to interact with. Now, it's only happened when I invited it, and now I feel like I'm in control. I can also swipe from the right, and now I can all of a sudden search my news, or I can share my news with somebody else, or I can launch something completely different. Okay, so this is leveraging the edge. Now, let's jump into navigation. What do we do to replace the navigation? Well, with Windows 8 apps, the navigation, again, the overarching principle is that we only want to tell users about where they are, not where they might go. So we don't render Chrome on the screen to try to get people to somewhere that they could possibly go, but we don't even know if they will. The fact is that a really well-designed app doesn't have need for this explicit navigation Chrome in most cases. Okay? Especially if it's laid out according to what we call the three-tier architecture, and I'll show you more about that in a minute. The three-tier navigation model, it's going to be set, the user's expectations for this is going to be set by a lot of apps in the store that already use it. Namely, the store uses the three-tier navigation model. You have a hub, sections, and a detail. The hub is an overall view of your app. You get to see essentially what the app is capable of at the hub. So as soon as you get to your app, you don't have to go digging and finding what it is that the app is capable of doing. A little bit of everything bubbles up to the surface. Not all of everything, just a little bit of everything bubbles up to the surface, and all your use cases are represented there. And then the user can dive into a section or dive into a detail pane, detail view, and he's able to eventually get to everything that the app is able to do. Does that kind of make sense to you guys? It's a major paradigm shift. It's not at all the way it was. And actually, I get a lot of comments that essentially say, hey, I feel like my discoverability is down. There's a trend these days, and you can easily see it most explicitly on the web, where everybody's, if the user has to click more than one time, it's a mortal sin, and we've got to do something about that. So we cram everything into one view. That one view is ultimately discoverable, because the user can see and read everything that they're able to do. And it doesn't work like that in Windows 8. You have very little on the screen, and we count on you knowing some of these fundamental commanding vectors in order to get to what they're trying to do or where they're trying to go. Okay, so the remaining seven more traits of a great Windows app design as a whole. This is all online. If you go to windowsuserexperience.com, you can get countless hours of video on the same thing. But I'm going to blaze through the rest. One of the traits of a great Windows 8 app is that it's fast and fluid, of course. Now, most of that is given to you with the framework. You use a built-in control. It's fast, it's fluid. You use the WinRT, which is our core library we'll talk about in a second. It's all asynchronous calls, so it's going to encourage you as a developer to create things fast and fluid. But to the degree that you do have some influence over whether the UI is fast and fluid, make sure that it is, okay? So if you have any control over it, go for it. Snapping and scaling, yeah, absolutely.
You said WindowsUserExperience.com?
Yeah, WindowsUserExperienceTraining.com.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry about that. It's the longest URL ever. WindowsUserExperienceTraining.com. So snapping and scaling beautifully is one of our eight traits of great Windows 8 design, and the reason is that Windows 8 is not just an OS that's going to run on a hardware device, end of story. It's an OS that is inherently flexible, inherently responsive, and it's going to be showing up on lots of different devices. So it might be on a really small tablet, or it might be on a television set. And it might be rotated horizontally or vertically, and it might be snapped. And if you haven't seen snapping, we'll see that in a bit. But Windows 8 apps have the ability to snap, so they show up in a little vertical pane next to whatever other app the user has going on. So you have two things going on at once. So your app might be landscape full screen, portrait full screen, it might be snapped, it might be what we call filled, which is when somebody's snapped next to you. It can show up in all these different ways, and we need to, as the developers, we need to respond really well to that. Now, who here is a tried and true HTML CSS person, and you fought that battle with divs and getting things to line up and lay out and respond? All right, now the story's really good for you because basically here's what happened. Microsoft said, we've got to create a great platform, and we've got to implement it in both XAML and HTML. Well, XAML, if you haven't seen it, is pretty incredible at doing layout. It's been absolutely great for UI. Now, HTML is good and extremely broad, and there's lots of people using it, but there's some very real pains in HTML. And Microsoft said that we're going to have to implement this so that it can keep up, so that it can be as good as XAML. And actually, in all of the controls and stuff, the goal was that the user doesn't even know whether it was made in XAML or HTML. And so we get some of these new features in HTML that are super exciting. We get grids, and we get flex boxes, and we get view boxes, and we get all kinds of things that make our development way simpler. And that all helps us to snap and scale beautifully, to show up in whatever screen, whatever orientation, and whatever environment we happen to be in. We want to make sure that we use the right contracts. When we're on a native device, we get to take advantage of some of the native features, and some of those are the ability to kind of universally search, universally share things out,
universally choose files or save files to a with a common UI, but to, you know, wherever that it might happen to be. And we want to make sure that we implement those, okay? We want to invest in a great tile, meaning that we want to not just have a static image that shows up on the user's start screen, but we want to use all the features of the tile. We want to make it dynamic so that it's actually getting updates, and not just informing the user, but also inviting them into your app. Because this is one of the ways that the user launches the app that you've created, is by seeing it on their start page and saying, okay, that's new, or that's fresh, or I've got a couple new messages, I want to open that app. That's good for you to do that. Now, there's also this other way that a user gets into your app, and that is by searching. I can, for instance, go search for a search term like New York, and then I can just click between the different apps, and it automatically searches into those apps. And it's actually launching your app to perform that search. So I might be searching for New York Steak, or the New Yorker drink from a bartending app, or I might be searching for New York in the Maps app, and maybe your application is a travel app. You want people to be able to, after they've typed in New York, say, hey, this app has something to offer me regarding New York. I might want to launch that. So it's a way in. You also want the user to feel connected and alive by implementing notifications. And these notifications work really well. You use a push server, like Urban Airship. You push these notifications into the app, and they can pop up as toast messages to tell somebody that they've got an email or whatever it is that they need to know. Roaming to the cloud, as our last solid one, I'll show you the design principles are a little bit different, but the roaming to the cloud is this principle that we want to let the user not just have their settings remembered, but also we want to give them the ability to roam their tasks. So, and this is extremely easy for the developer and extremely delightful for the user. So if my settings are being saved, that means that once I get to level 11 in the game that I'm playing, and then I turn off my device and I start another one, it knows that I finished level 11 on this other device because all my settings are automatically roamed to my cloud account and then roamed back down to my other devices. That's, again, extremely simple for the developer to implement. But we can also roam tasks. So we want to, for instance, if the user is riding a bus, writing an email, he gets interrupted on the bus, turns off the tablet, walks into work and turns on his computer, it's also running Windows 8, bam, he's right in the middle of that email. So we can roam those tasks for you. Now, the principles, the five principles are documented in design.windows.com. These seem a little bit esoteric at first, but these are good to study and know. And make sure when you're designing your app that you are considering each of these. So showing pride in your craftsmanship is just a matter of saying, you know what, user experience is the most important criterion, period, in your success. And so consider the placement of every pixel. Consider the beauty of the product overall. Consider all of those use cases. Okay, because you need to in order to have a successful app. But do more with less means that we basically aren't trying to pack a billion things onto the screen. We're trying to be essential. And we're trying to be inspiring. We're trying to be immersive. So your app should be that. Fast and fluid, we already talked about. It's important enough to be a design principle. Authentically digital means that we don't limit ourselves with real-world constraints. We are on a digital platform. We don't have these constraints. So we shy away from skeuomorphism and trying to represent things that exist in real life because they're familiar to the user at first, but then also we tie ourselves to that real-life scenario. So we tend to be authentically digital. Not that you don't have the capability of being skeuomorphic technically, but it's not the principles. And finally, Windows 1. For Windows 1, I always bring up the example of I'm in the airport, I get on an escalator, and by the time I get to the bottom of the escalator, I want to look up my trip advisor, trip information, and figure out where my hotel is, and then switch over to maps and find the restaurants that are in the area that I might like. Pick one, make a reservation at OpenTable, and then share that reservation with a colleague so that we all know where we're going out for dinner tonight. And then I get off the escalator. So I'm going to be able to do all of that in one quick usage scenario. And that doesn't just involve one app, it involves like five apps jumping from one to another and sharing this information from one to the other. So have that usage scenario in mind
when you're designing your app. So this is pretty much the end of the design section. We're going to move into development. I'm going to show you guys some things, but feel free to ask any questions that you have about design at this time. Yeah? Sure, an example of authentically digital versus the opposite. So authentically digital is the reason why the Windows 8 design was called Metro, and the reason why it looks Metro, it looks, you know, like a transit system or something, because it's essential. It's the information that you need and only the information that you need. And it is, you'll notice that we don't use rounded corners as like adornments. We don't use, we don't tend to use gradients too terribly often. We don't tend to, if we're making an application that is a graphic equalizer, we don't, you know, try to create all the sliders look like the sliders in a real graphic equalizer. We make them in a way that is touch friendly and easy for the user to recognize and easy for the system to render. So it's those types of things. Yeah.
We're recording this, so the microphone's awful.
So one of the questions I had is, I've seen a lot of discussion about the differences between, say, the Windows 8 Metro interfaces, which I guess isn't Metro anymore, but whatever it is, versus the and I'm forgetting the name, like the classic interface, right? So if we're building a new app, do we have to worry about building like that app launching in that classic interface and like supporting the old menu sort of UI stuff, or we just safely mentally set that aside and just deal with the stuff that looks good?
Good question. So the two different worlds are, and yeah, we did have this nice word Metro, we don't have that word anymore, but it was Metro and desktop. The terminology now is this. We have Windows Store apps, because they're apps that, you know, are going to show up in the Windows Store. It's the new style thing. You also hear them called modern. And then we've got desktop apps. So the desktop apps are the legacy or classic ones that are running in x86, you know, in Win32 on the desktop, the way we've always done it, using the standard .NET framework and Win32 APIs. And then we have the Windows Store apps. Now, when you're talking developer to developer, you can call them WinRT apps, because they're all based on WinRT, okay? So those are the two worlds that we're dealing with. Now, when you make a new app, and you're targeting WinRT, you want to be in the store, you want to use the new design, you want to, you know, take advantage of all the features, and essentially, your app will fit in as a WinRT app. It doesn't need to do something that WinRT apps are not allowed to do. But you're going to go ahead and create it as a WinRT app, and it's going to work on every Windows 8 PC. Right, so you don't have to make any considerations whatsoever for classic desktop artifacts like menus or windows or anything like that. You don't have to make any considerations whatsoever. That user will be running your app on a Windows 8 device in the WinRT shell, in the WinRT environment. Okay? Now, if you are creating a desktop app, that's a whole different ballgame. You're going to be able to target any machine that's running Windows 8 Pro, not Windows RT that you're going to get on, for instance, the Surface device that's released on Friday. It has to be a Pro device that's capable of running these legacy desktop applications. Okay? And then you're going to have, yeah, you're going to be targeting that app. You're going to be using the classic development techniques and platforms and frameworks and things like that. It's just kind of two different worlds.
Is the desktop just there for legacy, or in some cases is that necessary going forward?
The question is the desktop just there for legacy, or is that going to be useful in some cases going forward? B. The answer is B, because there are, let's use Adobe Photoshop as an example. Now, Adobe might decide that there are one or more great use cases that are fulfilled in a modern touch application, and they're going to implement those different use case scenarios in a WinRT app, in a Windows Store app. But in the Windows Photoshop Classic, there's like 1,000 billion different things that you can touch on the screen, that you can do on the screen, right? And it doesn't really lend itself to a modern application. So that's one of the things I love about the new platform is that it's very schizophrenic. You know, you can do both. If it ran on Windows 7, it runs on Windows 8.
Plus, there's this new modern interface that does all kinds of stuff much better.
So there's no push in Photoshop.
I would imagine that Adobe is trying to get elements of Photoshop into the WinRT environment. Don't quote me on that, I don't know what they're doing. But they're probably going to go forward with Photoshop Classic running as a desktop app. Yeah?
Yes,
so
Microsoft?
There's a microphone right here.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's right.
Is Microsoft going to have any recommended approaches for write once and deploy many? I want to write something that I want to target for the desktop and for Windows RT. Is there going to be a way to
get that question? I get that question all the time. It's a good question. We all want to write things one time, right? Now, there are two different, that question has two sides. One is, what if I want to write something that shows up on the desktop and in WinRT and maybe on the Xbox and maybe over here, you know, different platforms, you know. The answer to that is yes. We have a thing called portable class libraries where you can take these different platforms or targets and it will automatically find what they all have in common and you can write to that lowest common denominator. And everything that you can implement in that lowest common denominator you can, and then you can just bring that into your Xbox game, bring it into your Windows 8 app, bring it into your phone app, whatever, you know, wherever you need to go, and it'll work there, and then you can build on top of it, your UI.
Is that a compiler or analysis tool or something?
The question, is that a compiler or something? It's actually a, it's a project type, and so it's basically a collection of classes, it's a library. Yeah. And then the other answer, the other question that's usually in there is, what about, I mean, here we are talking about the web platform, what about writing it once on the web and having it work everywhere? This one's interesting. Okay, so I can take any old web app that's running on, you know, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. I can bring it into Windows 8 and it runs. It just runs, okay? It's a 5-minute job. Now, to give it some Windows 8 personality, I'm going to use what our native JavaScript library, which is called WinJS, and I'm gonna add some features to it that the normal web doesn't have. And I'm also going to use that library in order to talk to the WinRT under the scenes. And I'm going to be adding some of these Windows 8 characteristics to it. I'm going to be implementing search and implementing share, and I'm going to be doing the file picker and things like that. And so once I do a few of those things, I can't move it out of Windows 8 to the web anymore. But because it's all still HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, you end up with some creative architecture being able to create things in common hugely. JavaScript libraries, totally in common. CSS libraries, totally in common. Okay.
Let's do one more question about this. And I think a lot of questions will be answered once you do the next one here.
Yep.
So.
Just real quickly to jump back to your example of Photoshop, are you saying it's not physically possible to encapsulate the multitude of features and richness of an application, a desktop application, in the Windows Store app experience, and that 10 years from now we're still going to have Windows Store app mode and desktop mode to switch between?
No, I'm not saying that at all. Technically, completely possible. User experience-wise, not really. Not necessarily possible, because they're just two completely different user experiences. Now, the second part of your question was, are we still in 10 years going to have this split between these kinds of apps and these kinds of apps? Very possibly, actually. I mean, I'm speculating as much as you are. But very possibly, because of the completely different nature of the two types of apps. One saying, just give me power, and the other one saying, give me the light.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, okay, let's move into development now. And hopefully you guys will get to, who here writes code? Raise your hand if you write code. Okay, great. I'm gonna keep this one low slide, high Visual Studio camera. But I do have some slides. By the way, you guys are welcome to follow me at Code Foster or go to codefoster.com. I'm writing a lot about HTML and JavaScript in Windows 8, so if you're interested in that, you can feel free to follow me. Here's the architecture that we're looking at. This slide's been around since build last year, so it's been around for about a year. Basically, on the right, you have all your legacy stuff. Those are your desktop apps. They sit on the exact same things they always sat on. You write all the same projects that you may have written before. On the left is everything new. It still says Metro-style apps. It should say Windows 8 apps. Windows 8 apps are built on any of these three verticals, and they're all sitting on the WinRT API. So that's the key for you
for us color heads in the room, we want to know what the bits are, and the bits are WinRT API. That's what your WinRT apps are sitting on, okay? This is not .NET, it's not Win32, it's a brand new modern API that's built for fast and fluid because everything in it is asynchronous. If it might take more than 50 milliseconds, it's an asynchronous file, okay? So that's the architecture that you guys are targeting. Now, the cool thing about this is that you've got these different verticals, and so if you are HTML JavaScript, you write in your vertical, and you get some of the same benefits of being in the web world. You get the DOM, and you get all of these JavaScript libraries that you might use already. You can use jQuery, you can use Knockout, you can use all these different libraries already out of the chute. And you're still talking to the same exact WinRT API. So some serious advantages there. Now, if this is the web platform, let's see what this is made out of. So this is a slide that shows you a bunch of the stuff that was implemented in IE9. Now, when we're talking WinRT apps, we're talking about the same engine that's running IE10. And so we need to feel secure that IE10 is a great platform to run an app on. And it absolutely is. Now, if you come in with some hesitation about IE because of its adolescent years, I'm here to convince you that it's grown up. IE9 introduced a bunch of stuff. It brought it up to an HTML5 test number of something like 92. Not nearly good enough. We're working in numbers around 400 now these days. IE10 brought it really, up a lot further. This engine is, actually it's really incredible. And it implemented a whole bunch of new things. If you're in the web platform stack, you're going to recognize the web workers and the local storage and all these things. And these are all implemented in IE10. It's an incredibly robust and fast engine. If you go to HTML5 test these days, you're going to see that it scores a bit lower than Chrome on HTML5 implementation. But a lot of the things that it doesn't have in it are kind of some ancillary features or some Google-specific features. So feature breadth-wise, very good. And then as far as speed, I don't know if you guys are familiar with RoboHornet. Has anybody here used RoboHornet? I don't know too much about this because I just learned about this not long ago. But apparently this is a Google test suite. And if you look at the numbers on IE versus Chrome, in RoboHornet itself, IE is quite a bit faster, almost 10% faster than Chrome in a lot of cases. On RoboHornet, it's more than 10%. But I went to try to verify that, and so I ran it in IE, and it all ran, and it gave me a number of 26.89. And I tried to run it in Chrome, and it wouldn't finish the tests a couple times in a row. I don't know what that means, that it didn't finish the test. But anyway, it's an incredible platform. It's we call the engines Triton and Chakra. And Triton is running your HTML and CSS, and Chakra is the JavaScript engine. It's multi-threaded, and it's look-ahead, and it's all kinds of goodness built into that engine. And you can research that yourself if you want to see more about it. But if you want to look at some of the things that were built into the Windows 8 web platform, the web platform that's running Windows 8 applications, you can go to ietestdrive.com. This is an awesome site to go to. Do I have internet? I guess I haven't connected to it. Is it open or do I need a...
The security password.
Is it the guest?
Yeah, it's
a... Yeah, the guest network, yes.
Okay, and then...
Capital T, minus, like the little word minus. The number 5, and the word and counting.
All lowercase,
yes.
Awesome. All right, so you can go to ietestdrive.com, and ietestdrive.com is a site that we use to kind of show off IE and what it's capable of doing. What's nice to do is open this site and run it in the different browsers and use some of the features in it to test. Because, for instance, there's a test on here called Bubbles. And if you want to see all of them, you could go to the sitemap. And there's one called Bubbles. And there was an old JavaScript test app, if you're not familiar with it. It was called Bubbles. And it was essentially some balls bouncing around inside of a div. and then the different browsers would use that to test and see how fast they are. It wasn't very long before all the browsers were so fast that they couldn't differentiate. And so our JavaScript team created this, and it's just a lot of logos jumping around. And if I open this in Internet Explorer, I get these little Internet Explorer logos. And then if I open this in Chrome, I get little Chrome logos. And it tells you all the frame rates and things like that, and you can see what the common experience is. So we'll open bubbles in Chrome, get these little Chrome logos, there's a Gaussian blur that's going on every time the bubbles collide, and so it's really processor intensive, and you can just crank these up and you can directly compare them. But what I want to show you is, in IE, one of these tests is this browser surface. Now this is a bunch of photos that load up, and IE, because it's the same engine as Windows 8, is extremely awesome at recognizing touch, including multi-touch. And if you open the same demo in Chrome or Firefox, they're not capable of the multi-touch yet, but Microsoft's actually submitted this multi-touch to the W3C, and everyone's really excited about it. In fact, I think Google is going to implement the same type of thing. But in a web app, this is on the web, I've got full touch capability on this. And that's pretty fun. So this support again exists because we needed to be able to do this type of thing in a native app. And so all of that work went into both the browser on 10 and into Windows 8. And so you get all of this really out of the box in both. Okay? And you can browse this IE test drive all day long. There's all kinds of really cool things on there, so you can feel free to have a look at that. But what I want to do is I want to actually walk you through the creation of a simple, what's a good stopping time?
Another 20 minutes.
Okay, 7:30 or so, that sounds perfect. I want to actually go create a Windows 8 app, and you can see the HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, and kind of the structure of the whole thing. And then we can really discuss it from a developer point of view. Okay, you guys are still free up, absolutely, to ask the design questions, but we can really open that up to development questions as well, and kind of how you do things. So what I'm going to do is just launch Visual Studio, and I'm going to launch a fresh one. I've got another one open right now. And we're going to create a really simple app, and then I'm going to take you over and show you a full app that's got a lot of stuff in it, and see how that works. So here I am in Visual Studio. A quick note about the tools you've got. For creating Windows 8 apps, you've got Visual Studio 2012, and you get for free, you get Blend. So even if you use the free version of Visual Studio, the Express Edition, you can just go download that. It's free, not just because it's, Visual Studio is released now, but it's free not just because Windows 8 hasn't launched, but it's going to be free going forward. And Blend comes with it, even the free version. So this is cool, you get both tools for free. And Visual Studio, they're both kind of the same thing, but one of them is from a design perspective, and the other one's from a developer's perspective. That's the way I like to say it. So I like to say, if you're wearing a shirt like this, probably start with Visual Studio, because it probably means you're a geek. And even though you'll be able to use Blend for the design types of things, you probably want to start with Visual Studio. But if you have a shirt like this, then you're probably more of a blind person. Start there, and then you can jump over into Visual Studio when it gets a little bit geeky for you, okay? So they're both made for making apps, but they do so from a completely different perspective. So I'm going to jump into this brand new app that we're working on in Visual Studio, and I'm just going to use one of the project templates. And whenever you create an app in Visual Studio, if you're using the Express Edition, you'll see fewer features. This is the bigger edition, so there's lots of different project templates. But I'm going to create a JavaScript-based Windows Store app. I know that's small, but don't worry about that quite yet. And then, in this case, I'm just going to create a blank app, okay? So we'll just call it App 1, and I'm going to put that into go. This is going to be tough to type and talk.
What's there?
Yeah, I think I do. Okay, so what we have here is what's going to resemble an awful lot a web application. It's got the HTML, it's actually got a default.html, so that's where we're starting. It's got the CSS folder, and then it's got a JavaScript folder. So let's look at the default HTML first. Here's the default HTML, and this is a 100% standards compliant HTML5 file. There's nothing unique or particular about this. There's nothing proprietary about this. The only thing that you'll notice that might at first look proprietary is this here. So you see this like reference to a CSS file and some JS files that start with whack and then microsoft.winjs.1.0. This is just a shortcut for doing this. It's a custom scheme, so instead of an HTTP reference, this is just a reference inside this application. So it's, again, nothing proprietary. And then everything else here, there's a link, there's script, there's a body, there's P. And I'm going to go ahead and change this P to an H2. So it says content goes here, it's going to be large enough for you guys to see. And then I'm going to write us a button, and we'll call it go. Who knows what it's going to do, but it's going to say go. So if I control F5 this, by the way, control F5 runs it without debugging. It's a little bit faster than just hitting F5. And we have an app that, if I zoom out so that you can see the whole thing, I have an app that is just a web page running natively. Okay? It's a web page with the CSS and the JavaScript, and it's all running native on this machine. If I had crazy graphics going on, it would be graphic accelerated. So it's giving you that benefit of native app. So I've got the content goes here, and I've got a button, and it all looks like Windows 8 because the WinJS library has given me this CSS already written. There's about 4,000 lines of CSS code that are in the UI-Lite CSS that's part of the standard project template. And so it automatically has that black background and has the Windows 8 looking implements, things like that. Now, you'll notice that it's taking up the entire screen. So at first you might say, how in the world do I get out of this? Alt F4 will do it for you. Anytime you Alt F4 out of the WinRT app, it takes you back to the start screen, so I can just tap the Windows key and it takes me back to my desktop app that I was working on. It takes me back to Visual Studio. So that's the HTML file. Let's look at the CSS now. CSS is referenced. There's the UI dark CSS that's referenced from here, but there's also this default CSS that's referenced. So let's go take a look at that. This one's pretty small right now. It's just got an empty body tag, so there's essentially nothing defined in here. But I certainly could either define my own styles, or I could go override whatever was given to me in the UI light, so I can look like what I want it to look like. And then, as you can see, I also have these media queries with these vendor-specific properties like MS View State, with values of fill, full screen landscape, snap, and so on, so I can determine what I want this app to look like in each of those cases. So I could, for instance, go tell the body that I wanted the body, the background color to be different if I'm in snap view, which would be so good. Now let's go look at the JS file that is behind that. Now this default.html page is, this is the only app-specific JavaScript file that's in here. There's the WinJS library that's in here under the references, and you're free to go look at that. It's not like it's hidden or anything. You can go into base and UI.js, these two JS files, and you can look at all the JavaScript code that's given to you in that library, much like looking at the jQuery source or something. And by the way, you don't have to worry about minifying it because it's native, so it's not making these calls over the wire to get these resources. So let's look at the default, or the JavaScript that's in this app. It's just that right there. Now, by default, they all use this modular pattern so that our pages, since we're making a big app here, it might have broad scope, and you know, we're going to be working with JavaScript. We don't want everything to be in a global namespace. So by default, all of the pages, JavaScript is happening inside of a modular pattern, inside of the module. So we define that module, and since this is the default.js, this is the one that represents the app, and so the app's normal life cycle is represented in here. So I've got the onActivated method, which is going to fire whenever this app gets activated, and I've got the onCheckpoint, which is going to fire whenever the app is on its way out, going into standby or whatever. So I just write some code in there, and I'm capturing the life cycle. And besides that, there's not really any code written for this app besides this right here, app start. Okay? So that's the blank application. You also can create a grid application, and it creates the standard grid that you guys have seen with Windows 8 apps, all the tiles and everything. That's a good place to start if you're wanting to learn how the grid works and you're wanting to make an app that really looks like the grid application. But you might want to start with the navigation app. I'm just going to create one more project here. I'm going to add a new project. Instead of basing it on blank, I'm going to base it on navigation. We'll call this app 2. Okay. This is going to give me a whole new project. And I'm going to say that I want that project to be my startup app. And now in here, I still do have default.html. But remember my previous default.html looked like this. I had my content here. Inside the body, I had an h2 tag and a button. Well, in my new one, look at my default.html. Now instead of having any content, I have this control called a content host. And then I have a pages folder. And all of my individual pages, of which I only have one right now, called home, have their own glorious triptych, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So they all have their own HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. That means every page is kind of its own container. It has its own structure, its own style, and its own logic. And I get to navigate to that using this content host. So by default, home is the base page, the first page it gets browsed to. So if I go to the home.html, and I say, I'm home, and I make this h1, I make this an h1, and I say, I'm home, and I run this one. Now it says, I'm home here. This one's got a header, and I'm actually sitting on the home page. What we've done here is implemented a single page application architecture. Very popular thing to do these days. It's built into that navigation app. This is the project template that I start with almost every single time I make a game. I rarely start with a blank template, unless maybe I'm making a game and all I have is a canvas. I never start with a grid application because it's kind of heavy and I like to start with something lighter. So I start with a navigation framework almost every time. And then I get all my interpage navigation, and the nice thing is that the user is always sitting on default.html with default.js and any other JavaScript that I've referenced, always in scope. So it makes it very, very easy to work with the user's scope. If you're familiar with single page application architecture, you're familiar with that. Okay, so those are the two kind of blank apps that I'm going to show you. Now I'm going to show you a few things in an app that I've created called Code Show. Now you guys are welcome to find Code Show source code on the web at codeshow.codeplex.com. It's all available there, and you just go to source code, and you can browse the source code online, and you can download it, no problem. There's a follow link over here, so you can follow it and get news about, you know, what we're doing there and stuff. This is mostly an effort of myself and a couple of other colleagues, but like I said, you can browse all that code on here, but I've got it running. And I started from a navigation app, and as you can see, I've got this demos folder with a whole bunch of demos, each of which is an HTML, JavaScript, and CSS, and each one shows off some little tiny thing in Windows 8. So there's like 200 sample apps available on dev.windows.com, and you can go there and learn, you know, some of these things, but those ones are a little bit weightier, and sometimes it's difficult to find what you're trying to figure out with there. So that's why I made Code Show. And the Code Show, it enumerates all of these demos, and then you can code for them. So the first thing I want to show you, who here is JavaScripty enough to know what a promise is? It's kind of like a future, it's kind of like a deferred. You guys know what a deferred is? Jquery heads, okay. Not so many, okay. We'll go ahead and talk to it anyway. I'll show you that one as well. Let me save that one for later in case we can't get to it. I'll show you some of the little bit more essential things. So in the area of CSS, styling your apps, we have some CSS implements. They're not controls, they're just CSS properties that give you some excellent layout features. One of them is the CSS Flexbox. So if I launch this demo, I have these different instantiations of the demo that I can show you. So the first one is, just I just call it distributed horizontal. The red, green, and blue divs are in a parent that's just a div with a display value of flexbox. And then one more property added to it that said, I want you to distribute the children. Now, if you were trying to do this with regular div layout, try to get these things to be positioned so that they had the spacing that was equal, it would be really difficult. But with a flexbox, it's extremely simple. Now, this is currently a vendor-specific tag, -ms-flexbox, but this is a W3C standard, so the other browsers are trying to get this implemented as well. We had to hurry up on it because we had to fit it into Windows 8. But it'll not only do the distribution, but it'll also allow those children to flex themselves. So I can tell my children, I want, what I've done here is I've told the first one, I want you to flex with a relative value of 1, and I told the second one, I want you to flex with a relative value of 2. And so now these children have said, well, there's a little extra room in this flex box, so I'll go ahead and flex. I'll go ahead and take up some extra space. So if you've done some layout, that might make sense to you as a pretty huge advantage. You can also tell the children, when you reach the edge of the container, instead of just overflow scrolling or overflow hiding, I want you to overflow wrap. I want you to wrap down to the next line. So all of a sudden, you get these, you know, tiles. This actually is not how we implemented the start menu. And it's not how you implement a list in most cases in your app. But it looks like that. It's used for a lot of cases. And besides going horizontal, the flexbox is perfectly capable of going vertical as well. So I can lay things out distributed in a horizontal or a vertical fashion. Lots of control over things like navigation menus, horizontal menus, all kinds of stuff. Okay? Flexbox is really, really great for things like that. The next one is the CSS grid. Now the grid is like the best of both worlds between div layout that we've been doing for quite a while with positioning and stuff and floating, and table layout, which we all got our hands slapped when we tried to do table layout. You're not supposed to do that. It's an HTML. It has to be in CSS. So this is defined in the CSS, but it's defined as a grid, so you get all kinds of control over the children in this grid. And the coolest thing is that it gives you not just control over where it shows up, because you can do that with a div, but you also get control over the alignment of the children. So these children, A, B, C, and D, are just regular old divs. And they were just told to go to your quadrant, and they automatically snap to the size of the quadrant. And then stretch is what that's called, and stretch is the default, but you can also center, or left or right, or whatever, align all of those. You can also do spanning. So what you're looking at here is actually a 3x3 grid with the blue square that's in the first row, first column, was told to have a row span of 2, so it's spanning 2 rows. And then the green one is spanning 2 columns. So really good control over layout with the grid. We're kind of like structured layout, okay? This one's also submitted to the W3C. I don't know the exact status of the spec. And I think that at least one of the other browsers is trying to implement it, but it's not too far along, but it's fully implemented.
Does this positioning and styling ever
get
markup, or is there facilities available to
The control over these is entirely in the style sheets. What you're looking at here, and we'll go ahead and look at it in code show. I'll go ahead and show you this for the flexbox. Let's start there. I'm going to select the flexbox. Instead of launching it, like clicking on it, I'm going to go see the code. And so code show actually goes and looks in my project and finds the HTML, CSS, and JavaScript that shows that code. So let's look first at the HTML. This is all of those different sections. So look at the first one here, the distributed horizontal. That deserves a zoom. Go. So this first one is distributed horizontal is a div with 3 divs as children. And I've given it an ID so I can refer to it. But that's all you have for the structure. And then for the CSS, for the flexbox one, that's that distributed horizontal. I'm saying that for the, actually here it is too, the display, I want it to be a flexbox. just saying that it's a flexbox automatically is going to lay out its children as a flexbox. But then I got a little bit more control over this one and said I want to change the packing to distributed. And then I told, I gave some of the children some size and color and stuff, but the children didn't have to know anything about it. And then I'll show you real quick on the grid. Let's go to the grid and look at that one. Let's look at the CSS. And if you look at the CSS for the first one there, same thing. All I did was tell the display of the parent, I want you to be an MS grid. And I want two columns that are 250 pixels each, and I want two rows that are 250 pixels each. And you can define those absolutely as pixels, or you can use what are called fractional units, and you can define them relatively. In fact, if you look at the grid, and you look at this second one here, the way that these columns are defined is 100 pixels, one fraction, and then 100 pixels. Which means that, and unfortunately my demo doesn't do this quite yet, but if this gets expanded or contracted, that center cell is the only one that grows and shrinks. The top and bottom rows and the left and right columns remain locked at 100 pixels. So you can see that with almost no code at all, I've done what would solve a lot of our problems when we're laying out a website. And then grids can also get fancy. You know, this is, you can imagine that you could create some tile look using grids and spanning and stuff like that. So that's grids. Any questions on flex boxes and grids?
Is there a fallback? Like, is there going to be a native Microsoft fallback for keeping it outside
of that? A native IE fallback? No, because.
Or a native Microsoft fallback?
Well, right now, because the flex box is implemented in the other browsers, then you would just be implementing multiple CSS tags. You would implement -ms-flexbox and webkit-flexbox. Yeah, you would do that if you were creating this for the web. If you're creating it for a Windows 8 app, one of the nice things about creating a Windows 8 app is you're targeting IE10, and that's about it. So that's the limits your ability to crow. I have to do multiple things. Now, there's a whole bunch of samples in here, but the one more that I want to show you is this implementation of asynchronicity, just because this is a really awesome thing to invite into the web platform, which has been notoriously synchronous and difficult. Until the advent of Ajax, and then all of a sudden we have the capability of doing async, but we don't really have haven't had until now a really great way of utilizing that asynchronicity in our JavaScript app. But now, with promises, the concept is this. I'm going to press start, and you can see that the start button doesn't change its color. That's because it froze my UI for 3 seconds while that synchronous task was running. Now I'm going to press start on the second one. This is an asynchronous task, and you can see that it finished immediately. That actually was a lie, because it took three seconds for that to happen as well, but it lied to me and said that it happened immediately because I'm not capturing that asynchronicity. Now in the third one, not only am I able to wait until it's finished, I'm also able to get progress back every time my asynchronous task increments. So when I press start, now I'm able to, every second, I'm able to update my UI in a very asynchronous fashion. And if you look at this demo, if you want to dig into this, you can not only utilize promises, but it's really easy with the WinJS framework to create a promise. And now you've made a method that is, for the consumer, an asynchronous method. So they get to call it, and then immediately have the control returned to them, and then you get to tell them whenever it's made progress, and you get to tell them whenever it's completed, okay? So there's absolutely tons more on the topic of design, absolutely tons more on the topic of development, and these are, I usually show a number of these to give the concept of what you're capable of doing in the framework and show the code behind it, but obviously we don't have time for that. But if you guys have, if any questions have come to mind based on what we've seen, or even if it's outside of that, is now the time for questions?
Yes.
Awesome. Questions?
So, I guess, so WinRT is running on IE10. That's what we're looking at when we launch each of those apps, right?
WinRT is running on Windows, and IE10 is running on a different, but the same engine, but it's running in a separate process.
So I guess, to what extent is the presentation engine used to Windows apps tied into the IE product?
So it's not. So IE is a browser that sits on top of an engine, and so these apps are not tied into the IE product. but they are sitting on the same engine that runs IDE. That sits on IDE. You see this tile here? This is JavaScript Chakra. That's that same engine that's sitting below Internet Explorer if I'm running Internet Explorer.
Where does it actually meet the metal in terms of the JavaScript communicating with the actual underlying API and what language was that implemented in, since that's C++?
So the WinRT API is entirely native code, so it's entirely C++. And you're communicating directly with that through what's called a language binding, or we call it a projection. So in your JavaScript, like, you don't even need to use the WinJS library, that's just kind of a wrapper, a helpful thing. But in your WinJS code, I can, for instance, let me do one thing real quick. Let's flip back to my blank app, or this is my navigation app. And this is the home page, and I'm going to go to the home.js, and there's a ready method for the home.js, and I'm going to say Windows dot, and it's going to give me IntelliSense looking into the Windows namespace, and what I'm actually looking at is WinRT projected into JavaScript. It's also projected into C#. It's also projected into C++. So we're not talking about a layer. This isn't like a layer that's taking up performance or anything. This is direct language binding. It's like we're writing WinRT, and I can, for instance, type Windows.UI.popups. Message dialog. A message dialog is a Windows RT concept. And I can just say hi, and then I can call show async on that. So now whenever I run this app and it goes to the home page, it fires that dialog box, and I just, from JavaScript, call the Windows RT API. That's a very simple illustration, but I could also call up in the interface for the webcam, and all of a sudden I got a webcam.
If the language implementations are all this projection, is there any technical reason to choose C# over HTML?
There are still technical reasons, although we've tried to minimize the technical reasons and make all the three, parity and parity.
Can you summarize them? Can you summarize?
Yeah, they certainly can, yeah. As soon as I'm able to speak. So the three languages are going to result in UI that the user theoretically can't tell the difference between. With performance, that meets all the thresholds such that the user can tell the difference. But behind the scenes, we all know that C# and C++ and JavaScript are very different environments. And so there's kind of some characteristic things about each that's different. If you're familiar with C# and XAML, you know that it's got out-of-this-world media support. I mean, it's the streaming media that's in XAML and C# was used for the Olympics and Super Bowl, and I mean, it's incredible. And you get all of that, or at least most of that, when you're writing your Windows 8 app on C# XAML. And in the web world, although we just got video and audio tags, and we've still got a little bit of standards battle going on, and we've still got a little bit of a limit there. Now there's some things like media framework and stuff like that to help with that. But there are these characteristics of the languages are definitely going to show up, so that if you know the web platform, by all means use the web platform. If you've got a team that already knows C#, by all means use it. I think the shared skill set is the biggest thing that we can.
So my question is around accessibility.
Okay.
If something like a screen reader or a refreshable braille display, it sees whether a web app is rendered inside of a different engine or inside of as a native app, it's going to see it as a web app versus a native app and describe those elements as such. In what ways does the MSAA lever love that API transition over to the ARIA API, where a screen reader can interpret?
I wish I had a more complete answer. I know that there is a lot of accessibility support in there, but I'm not very good in the area of accessibility. I don't know tons about it. So I know that, like you said, it's gonna detect that it's web assets and things like that it's gonna be doing the accessibility for. But all of these web assets are actually translated into the Windows framework eventually. Windows has a concept of a button, even though it's an HTML button, and it has a concept of a generic element with accessibility properties and attributes and stuff like that, even though they're HTML attributes. And so I know that there's really, really rich accessibility support. I just can't tell you, like, from developer to developer, what all that entails. So.
Well, I've got a question. Let's say I'm just a really lazy web developer, and I've got a pre-existing HTML5 app with jQuery, all standalone. It's great. Pretty out there. Does this mean I can just literally copy and paste my code into Visual Studio, say build it, not have a code save version?
Yes / no.
My goal is, yes, please elaborate.
Great. The yes part of that is that absolutely yes, that'll just work. With a couple of caveats that are honestly very minor. One of them is that jQuery does some cross-domain checking that you have to make sure you basically authorize it, you know, under the covers so that it's going to work. The other thing is that, so you've brought this web app into Windows 8. It now looks like a web app running on Windows 8 with some of the constraints that we had on the web. And you want to definitely open those up. You want to use the whole screen. You want to use, you know, the sharing contract. You know, you want to add that extra functionality. But one of the examples I always show there is cut the rope. Have you guys seen cut the rope? It was an iPhone app, and they ported it to the web platform before Windows 8 existed. And the performance was excellent, absolutely excellent in JavaScript. And now they brought it over into Windows 8, and they said that it took it was less than 15 minutes to get it running on Windows 8, and then 2 more weeks to make it a genuine Windows 8 app.
That's the killer.
What kind of support do you have for like 3D acceleration and like OpenGL or DirectX? Could you do that with the HTML or the JavaScript? What kind of support is built into that?
With the JavaScript, no, there's not really a 3D engine that's running with JavaScript. If you want to do 3D, you're going to need to do DirectX. And so you're going to need to either write a native C++ with DirectX, which is going to be a great down the metal bare bones, you know, kind of solution. Or if you want to be a little bit higher level, then you're going to want to use something like, I know a lot of people are using something like Mongame on C#, or they're using a lot of gaming engines. So like my shirt here is the Game Salad engine by Tamron. And there's a lot of people doing that type of thing for good 3D support. Now, you do have acceleration in the 3D and 2D world. So if you're doing gaming in JavaScript, and even though you don't have the rich 3D story, you've got a good 2D gaming story, and it's all hardware accelerated. So. And you've got some, you know, the kind of the quasi 3D stuff, like you've got 3D transforms and CSS and things like that, but it's not real 3D.
So, what if someone wants to write an application that works on platforms other than Windows and also Windows, and they want to share some of the code? So, I saw that you. One of the layers you can create stuff in is C++, which is also supported on Android and iOS as a lower level, and then you can write the user interface in the native of the platform. Is there any guidelines you would have for someone who is going to port an app that's already been written for something else into Windows 8?
No/yes. No is that although we have C++ and so does Android, the language is the minor part of the whole thing. There's the language and then there's the object model that C++ is talking to, and the two worlds are very, very different between if you're talking to WinRT with your C++ and Windows 8, between that, or if you're talking to Win32, that and the Android. So you're not really going to get code share at that level between the two different platforms. They're just two different. So if you want to share code with Android and iPhone, actually I think the web platform is the best way to do that. Even that or doing things at a service level. I always recommend that people move more of their application code to a service level instead of just trying to get everything to work on that one machine. Move as much as you can up to the service level, and now it's going to be delivered to whatever UI you have to make. Now, if you're talking about too low-level stuff, too client, too fat, like, you know, too much fat stuff, then you're going to need to pick, or you're going to need to use something like what I was talking about before with portable class libraries, which is basically just targeting different types of platforms. I don't know. Well, except for
the Mono platform. I don't know of any other good, you know, true cross-platform stories.
Some of the Xamarin.
Oh, okay. So that's a little bit higher level. The Xamarin thing is you're going to be creating an abstract game, and it's going to be published into the different platforms using their native code. And there's a lot of different stories for that. There's this one, and then there's Skira, and then there's Yo-Yo Games, and then there's PhoneGap for using web platforms. So there's a lot of different stories that basically take you up to a higher level of abstraction, and then they write the lower things for you. You get all kinds of advantages to that, and you get all kinds of disadvantages to that. Does that answer your question? Well, no.
Sort of. No. But I mean, it's like, I definitely, some of the worst apps that I've experienced are where they were written originally for some other platform, and then they try to just, like, duplicate the experience on a different platform, but like each platform has, if you're used to using it, the platform has a certain way of doing things.
Exactly.
Like the, you know, you're explaining with like edge effects.
Yep.
And like not having the actions on the icon, but having it on the long bar. And, you know, I experienced where, you know, people did a straight up experience port. And it's like, those are always terrible because it's like whatever you're used to being using the platform is wrong.
Yep.
And so I knew that for definitely on the user, the user experience level, you need to absolutely rewrite that. But you know, some things like being able to create a thumbnail from a large image, maybe you can copy that kind of code. Yeah.
Yeah, almost all my stuff's at codefoster.com. It's if you search for some of the generic terms like design, then you'll probably find multiple places where I've published the slides online that are maybe not exactly this close.
You were recommending the tiered approach for providing services and layer. So would these services be provided, are you saying on a per machine, as WinRT, something WinRT or something Win32, and what kind of IPC mechanisms are available on the machine itself to do that?
Okay, so there's not really IPC mechanisms, WinRT to WinRT. You wouldn't be working that way. You'd be working with classic services with serial communication, you know, with text-based communication. If you're talking shared process functionality and stuff, then I would look into something like a cloud provider's queuing or in service bus type things. But you're not, I mean, you can't even talk from one WinRT app to another on the same machine, let alone talk to a WinRT app on another machine. You can use classic, you know, RPC strategies for, you know, legacy processes, but, and you're free to do that, but you have to keep in mind that with your store apps, with your WinRT apps, they can communicate with public endpoints. And so it's going to have to be available as a public endpoint. And I would encourage you to write it in something that's delivering, JSON.
So, Jeremy,
yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
And Matt just told me that I managed to get the last question, which is awesome. But Jeremy will be around after, for, I'm sure, for questions. I'm going to ask a complete tangent. You have a laptop that's got a touch screen on it.
You do.
I noticed that. And you haven't yet, didn't mention it at all. And so you've got this combination of touch screen, form factor, and keyboard, and I'm not sure if there's a touch pad on the thing, but like, how have you found yourself using that touch screen? Like, do you use it in day-to-day work or only when you're presenting, or like, you know, what does the interaction, how are you personally finding that?
Delightful. I like it a lot. I tend to use the different thing. I actually also have a Kinect sensor, so I can, like that.
Do you use that at all?
No, I don't have a Kinect sensor. I'm using the
Okay, all right.
think about your input, you know, you just kind of do it naturally, and so you find yourself, sometimes you touch the screen, and you didn't, you know, you didn't think about it, you just did it, and then you go to the mouse for other things, and you go to the keyboard for other things, and then it's kind of evolved, like I've had to get used to the idea of having that option, you know, and now I do it all the time where I'll touch an email, and then I'll hit Control R, and I'm like, wait, why did I do that? I touched the email to select it, but then I hit Control R on the keyboard to reply instead of tapping, you know, touching the reply button. And so it's really nice having that, the, you know, all of those different input techniques. And, but did I miss any part of your question? I mean, that's the way I naturally use it in my attempt to explain
why. Well, that was it.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And the downside is that now, like, if you loan me your laptop, I'll get fingerprints all over it, even if it's not a touchscreen device.
Yeah. I was wondering, like, external monitors, I mean, might be the same sort of.
Yeah, it is an adjustment. I have Windows 8 running on my TV at home. It's actually running on the PC that's hooked to my TV, and I touch my TV all the time.
Okay, so we don't have any time for more questions right now. We're going to be around for the next 15, 20 minutes while I take questions. Thank you for coming out. This has really been interesting. Like I said earlier, remember, next month is early and not here. The announcement will be out in a few days. Thanks for coming out.
See everybody.